Check, 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 test, test, test. Check, 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 test, test, test.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. I just want to welcome you to Sun Lake for our Florida Standards night, where we'll talk about this. Do I need another mic? Can you hear me? Oh, I hate microphones. Two mics and a remote. I'm not going to do it. Okay. Good evening. Is that better? I'm not going to holler at you. Okay. We are very grateful to you that you took the time to come out tonight to talk with us. We want to talk to you about new standards, but a new vision for our district, new standards, and then also give you an opportunity to ask questions. So tonight will be divided into a couple of different parts. Once we finish our introductions, we're going to talk about our vision for education in Pasco County. What really are we trying to accomplish here? And then we want to talk to you about the standards that are new, that are going to be implemented in our schools. And then we want to talk to you a little bit about how we are doing that in Pasco County, and then save some time for your questions at the end. Speaking of questions, you got an agenda as you came in. There are a few ways for you to provide your questions or to give your questions to us. There is a QR code and a URL right on your agenda that you can scan or click into if you have a smartphone or a device. You're welcome to provide some questions that way. If you would prefer, there's some lines there for you, of course, to write down questions. And when we get to a point in the presentation, we'll collect those up so that we can make sure to be able to answer those for you today. If you have teacher-specific, student-specific, school-specific questions, those are difficult to answer in an audience like this, and so we'll save that for some district staff who are here who can help us with those kinds of questions and really try to focus tonight on questions that you have about our vision and our standards in our county. I want to make sure to introduce and recognize a few people. So first, thank you to Mr. Steve Williams, the principal of Sun Lake High School, and some of his administrative staff who are here and open their facility to us tonight. We appreciate that. Thank you so much. We also have some other area administrators, school-based administrators who are here. So if you are a principal or assistant principal from one of our local feeder patterns, if you could please stand up and let us know that you're here. Thank you also for coming. We also have many district staff members who are also here tonight. I failed to introduce myself. I'm sorry about that. I'm Vanessa Hilton. I'm the director for the Office for Teaching and Learning. I have one of my colleagues who's also going to be speaking with you this evening, as well as some various other district staff members who are also here to support this evening. We also have Ms. Amelia Van Name Larson, who's our Assistant Superintendent for Student Achievement, who is here. As well as our Superintendent, Mr. Kurt Browning. And so before we get started, I'm going to turn this over to him.
And we are glad you're here. Let me see if I can stand right here so I don't block anybody. This is really odd. Steve, can we get this column out of here? Where are you? It just holds a wall up or a roof up. We are thrilled that you're here and taking your time tonight to learn more about the Florida standards. This is number 12, I think, This is 11 out of 13. We have gone to, or will have gone to, all 13 of our high school feeder patterns. And what we wanted to do is give our parents, our community stakeholders, the opportunity to learn more about the standards and what it means to your kids, your students in school. One of the things we hope to accomplish tonight is talk to you about what the standards are, but just as importantly, what they are not. We get a lot of phone calls from moms and dads because they've heard X, Y, and Z about the Common Core. And you'll hear tonight that we're not going to refer to it as Common Core. It is still the same standards with a couple exceptions. We will now refer to them as their new name, which is the Florida standards. Recently, the State Board of Education made changes. They adopted about 98 changes to the Common Core before they renamed it the Florida Standards. Of that 98, I believe about 52 of them were calculus standards. Calculus did not have any standards in the new standards. So now there's 52 calculus standards in the new standards. A number of these remaining standards were just changes of words, wordsmithing in the existing standards. The one thing that was added in addition to the calculus standards was cursive handwriting. We will be teaching, going back to teaching cursive handwriting probably next school year. Is that correct, Ms. Larson? Next year. So we will be, you will start seeing your kids learn cursive handwriting next year. So that's what's happened. They've now come back and they've rebranded the standards as the Florida standards because we in fact made changes to those standards. So one of the purposes tonight was to get your questions answered. What we will do is Ms. Hilton has said and Ms. Mitchell, they will provide some information to you. Because I believe that through the course of the presentation tonight, it's a brief presentation, that it will begin to answer some of the questions that moms and dads have about the standards. What they are, what they aren't, how they're going to impact your kids, what we're doing in the Pasco District as it relates to the standards. Now that being said, let me just pause just a moment and let me take the standards and get them off the table because I don't want to talk about the standards for just a minute. One of the things that that we want to make sure that mom and dads understand is this. Regardless of the standard, we're currently teaching Next Generation Sunshine State Standards. Next Gen is what we call it. Is that correct? Sunshine? A mixture. In some grade levels, we are teaching Common Core, Florida Standards. But we have, up to this point, been teaching Next Gen Standards. It makes no difference what standard we're teaching. Because where you're going to see a change in your student's classroom is the way that we are delivering instruction to your kids. Okay? Forget the standards. If we were staying with the existing standards that we're teaching now, or have been teaching for the last 8 to 10 years, you would still see a change because of the way that we're delivering that instruction back to your kids. What do you mean, Superintendent? Well, it looks different. It looks different. It engages the kids more readily than the way that we have traditionally taught our children in our classrooms. One of the things that we're finding is that our kids are not engaged in their learning. We talk in the district about our students needing to be able to own their education. They need to own their education. Typically in middle school, particularly in high school, not so much in elementary school, but you will find, and I'm painting with a broad brush, but what we will find is that the days of, as I affectionately say, the days of flipping pages are over in the Pasco District. We should not have teachers standing at the front of classrooms any longer saying, take your textbook out, turn to chapter 6, and begin to read chapter 6 to you. We all know that that is not engaging. That does not engage. And what do? We have historically, forever and a day, I did it, you did it. We feverishly took notes that the teacher was giving us. For what purpose? To take a test. And then what happened after the test? Poof, disappears. Because why? We've got more information to feverishly take notes on, to study, to memorize, and to take a test. And so what you're going to see, particularly as we move to middle school and high school, is a change so that there is much more engagement, there's much more collaboration, much more teamwork, there's critical thinking skills, there's problem solving that's being taught, as best you can teach that. You know, if you have kids, I'm a dad of two grown boys, and I cannot begin to tell you the number of times that I've looked at my boys and said, what are you thinking? Or better yet, are you thinking? And so what we need to do is we need to make sure that our kids can make the connection between what they're being taught in a classroom and real life. You will hear over and over and over again tonight the phrase college, career, and life ready. College, career, and life ready. That is our mission. That is our mission as a school district, to ensure that your children, our kids, our students, are college, career, and life ready. So that's going to change the way that we deliver instruction in the classroom. Now, if you want to overlay the new standards, that's fine. You can do that now. And we're going to spend a lot of time on these standards. But I wanted to draw the distinction between what's actually happening in our classrooms and the standards. The other point that I want to make is that we're going to talk about standards tonight and not necessarily curriculum. There's a difference between the standards. The standards are the what. The standards are the what. What do we want our children to achieve? The benchmarks, the goals. The curriculum, which is all locally decided by your school board and your school district, and in large part driven by your teachers in the classrooms at each school. The curriculum is the how. How do we get to these standards? And our teachers need to have the flexibility to be able to teach each child individually in order to get each child to those standards. When I became superintendent, one of the things that I was railing against was the fact that we were teaching reading and writing and mathematics pretty much the same way across the county, regardless of what kind of school it was and what kind of neighborhood they came from. And I think that if we were to all look at ourselves, we would all realize that we all learn differently. We learn at different rates. We learn differently. Some of us can see it and learn it. Others have to hear it. Some of us have to touch it to learn it. Some of us have to practice over and over and over to learn it. So what we were doing is we were teaching reading and writing and mathematics primarily the same way across the district. And what we're doing now is we're looking not only at schools, but we're also looking at individual classrooms and seeing how we educate our kids in those classrooms. And we go even deeper than that, and we look at each individual student. I remember telling teachers that a number of months ago, and I remember this teacher came up to me after I had made my comments, and they said, "But Superintendent, we understand what you're saying, but that is hard work." And we say, "Yeah, that is hard work. But if we want our kids, if we want your children to be college, career, and life ready, to be able to compete globally, then we have to change the way that we deliver instruction to these kids." I get busted on a little bit when I talk about preparing our kids to compete globally, because after all, this is just Pasco County. Do you know where Pasco County is? I call it the crown of Tampa Bay because it sits right across Hillsborough and Pinellas counties. There is a major international airport 30 minutes from here. There is a major port, water port, that international businesses locate to the Tampa Bay area. When those businesses relocate, start up in Tampa Bay, I want to make sure that our kids, your kids, can compete for those jobs in those businesses. I don't want those kids in Hillsborough County and Pinellas County getting those jobs because our kids aren't prepared. So we are committed as a district to make sure that each one of our students are college, career, and life ready. It's a mantra. It is what we do. It's who we are. And the thing about it is you will see those changes. If you have elementary school students, you may have already started seeing those changes. You may have already started seeing that the classroom looks differently. I would encourage you to go into your child's classroom. See what's different. The last thing I'm going to tell you is this, and then I'll turn it over to Ms. Hilton. Ms. Hilton. Your child will come home, and they will say to you, "This is hard. This is hard. I can't get it." They may come home with tears streaming down their cheeks. Parents, it's okay. It's okay. I am a firm believer that school needs to be a little bit hard. If it's not hard, then where's the learning? Where's the challenge? If our kids are going to be coming into the classrooms and just learning what they already know, where's the learning in that? How are we preparing our kids to be college, career, and life ready? So it's okay for them to feel the pressure a little bit, but it's going to be age appropriate, I'll assure you, I promise you. But I will also encourage you to talk to your children's teachers. Talk to your teachers. That's the first line of defense. Always have those conversations with your child's teacher. The second line is talking to your child's principal. I want my principals to manage their schools. I want our teachers to have control of their classrooms, to have the academic freedom to be able to teach in that classroom and get those kids where they need to be so that they're college, career, and life ready. And where does that begin? It begins at home before they come to kindergarten, but it begins for us in kindergarten. College, career, and life readiness in kindergarten. It's there, it's here at our doorsteps, and we've got to be ready for it. So I'm looking forward to tonight, and I'm going to turn it over to Mrs. Hilton, and we have a short, brief presentation, and then we're going to get to your questions because we want to make sure you get your questions answered tonight. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you so much. I do want to mention to you guys that we are doing live streaming tonight. So just in case you don't want to be on camera, you can turn or scoot to the side, but we are being live streamed just to make sure everybody knows that we're taping this evening. Again, I'm Vanessa Hilton. I'm the director for the Office for Teaching and Learning. And before we even start to share the standards with you, I really want to talk to you about our mission, our vision for education in Pasco County. And you've seen this slide back here behind our Superintendent Browning. And I want to explain it a little bit further. And he touched on some of the things I'm going to talk about, but I'm going to go a little bit more in depth. We do have a promise to fulfill for our students. And it is that we will create learning opportunities that will give them the skills, the dispositions, the knowledge to be college, career, and life ready. We are going to use that term quite a bit because we understand what the definition of that is, and it's become part of what we do, part of our way of work. But I want to make sure that I define it for you so that you know exactly what we're talking about when we talk about college, career, and life ready. There's actually not just one simple definition of college, career, and life ready. It has some components to it. The first component is that we want to ensure that the learning opportunities we're creating for our students create deep academic knowledge and understanding. This is different than opening up a textbook and answering some questions so I can prepare for a test at the end of the week. This is a way of providing opportunities for students so that they truly own their learning, so that they understand a concept or an idea to a depth that they really can apply the knowledge that they've learned in other situations. College, career, and life readiness is not only that, though. College, career, and life readiness includes 21st century skills. And I'm not just talking about technology, although that's part of it. And so certainly being able to use a computer, a tablet, a smartphone, access the internet, do some research, all of those are important pieces. However, that's not all that we're talking about when we talk about 21st century skills. We're also talking about critical thinking. When I go on the internet, am I paying attention to where the information comes from? Anyone can post something on the internet. I need to be a critical consumer. Our students need to be critical consumers of what's there. Is it reliable? Is it valid? Does it help me learn what I need to learn based on what we're doing in my classroom? In addition, we need them to be able to solve problems. We need them to be able to engage in problem solving. There's probably oftentimes in your life, in your professional life, in your personal life, you just come across a situation and you have to think critically about it and you have to engage in problem solving. What's my problem? What am I going to do about it? How am I going to solve this? And I'm not just talking about mathematics. I'm talking much broader than that. And so those are skills also that we need to ensure that our students have. In addition, we want students to be able to work together. Certainly, we will engage students in their independent learning, and we want them to own that knowledge at the end of the day. However, many of the jobs out there today require collaboration. We need students to be able to work with others in order to problem solve, think critically, and engage. Lastly, we know we have to pay attention to each child's social and emotional learning. It's not just about deep academic knowledge. That's super important. It's not just about deep academic knowledge and 21st century skills. It is also about social-emotional competencies, like when things get hard, am I able, are our students able to take risks, to think beyond the scope of what they've learned so far, and to try harder, to persevere through when things are difficult. I am sure many of you have had a day where you've just said, this day was hard. We don't quit our jobs, though, when things get hard, right? Still have to pull in a paycheck. We have to think about how we go back and try again. What's another way to do this? How do we come back and persevere through tough days and tough times? Those are skills we must be teaching our students as well. And we also want our students to have empathy, because those 21st century skills that require critical thinking and collaboration, when you work with other people, you have to have empathy and think of other people. And lastly, we want to make sure that we're creating opportunities for our students to be productive citizens. I once heard a speaker who said, I'm going to retire in the world that my students will run. And never has that hit me so hard as when my own students graduated from high school. Troubling. It is very important. We all know in this room that we will retire. We will step down from the post that we're at. And the students who sit in our classrooms right now, from kindergarten to 12th grade, will have an influence on our communities. They'll either have a positive influence or a not so positive influence. It's our job to make sure that they can be as productive as possible to lead our communities to where we need them to be. I'd like to talk to you a little bit more about that social-emotional learning, if I could. Part of the 21st century skills and social-emotional come together in some explicit skills and some implicit skills. And I'm not going to read them all to you. I'm going to direct your attention to some, though, that are more important than some of the others. And that is self-direction. You're not always going to be right beside your kiddos. Teacher's not always going to be standing right beside your students. So we need them to be able to take a look at problems, know how to start, know how to persevere through them, know how to just get started on their work, and how to take control of their own learning. Because in the end, we do want them to own their learning so they can apply it in multiple situations. We spoke about when things get hard, making sure kids have perseverance, but also that grit. I don't want to stop. I want to try again. Who can I ask for help? How can I do this collaboratively with other people? And we also know that we have to pay very close attention to motivation and engagement. Our children live in a world where they can pick up a device and get instant feedback when they're playing games or when they ask a question, literally just ask a question. When they engage in any research, they can get instant feedback. Classrooms have to change so that we can engage those learners. They learn in short spurts. They want instant feedback to know whether they're on the right track or not. We have to ensure that our classrooms change so that we can create those opportunities for our students. We can be focused on creating deep academic knowledge, integrating those 21st century skills, and creating opportunities for students to be as productive as possible. Let me tell you why it's so important for us to think about how our classrooms are going to look different. I shared with you our vision for what education would look like, but let me tell you that we're not there yet. We're not at a point where we can say we have been able to create these opportunities. We're working on that. This is a work in progress. But let me give you a compelling why to the reason to make these shifts and changes in our classrooms. And it has to do with our data. Every year, we graduate students from our high schools. The group of students who graduated in 2011, only 66.7% of them scored high enough on college placement tests in reading, math, and writing to avoid remedial coursework at the post-secondary level. That's really important to you as parents, because if students have to take remedial courses at community college or at the university level, you get to pay for them, and they don't get credit for them. But they have to take them in order to get to learn those skills and then be able to engage in credit-bearing courses. It's very important. It's important to you as parents, but it's also important to our community, because that ends up being time and money resources that don't have the payout that we're expecting in terms of students earning credit in college. Of those students who graduated in 2011, less than 50%, but close to 50% of them actually enrolled in a post-secondary institution that fall. We know all of our students will not go to college, but we know that we want to create opportunities so all of our students can make that choice for themselves. So they're not limited because they didn't score high enough on some tests in order to be able to graduate, or they didn't score high enough on enough tests in order to be able to get into a college. We want everyone to have that choice to make for themselves. And 50% is probably not high enough. Of that 50% who did attend a post-secondary institution in the fall of 2011, only 74.3 of them earned a GPA of 2.0 or higher. Also important to you as a parent and our community, because in college, if you don't earn at least an A, B, or C, you're not going to get credit for that class, but you get to pay for it. And if a student continues not to earn at least a 2.0, they'll be on academic probation, and later, the college may not ask them to come back. So that's very important that we're creating deep academic knowledge and that we're also creating those social-emotional competencies so our students will engage in tough courses. They will want to learn hard content because that's what's going to help them succeed at this post-secondary level. I want to give you a little piece of information about why these numbers might look the way that they do. With our traditional standards and our traditional track to high school graduation, so not advanced, I'm not talking about kids who engage in dual enrollment and advanced placement and international baccalaureate, but in our traditional track to a high school diploma, the standards were planned from kindergarten to 12th grade. So our last batch of standards, not the standards we're going to talk about tonight, but our last batch of standards, the planning started at kindergarten, then it went to first, then it went to second, and so on. An interesting thing happened when we got to 12th grade. Between that traditional track to a high school graduation, where that ended in terms of the kind of text that we engage students in, the expectations that we had for students at that level, there was a gap between there and the expectations of a freshman entering post-secondary. That gap kind of is suggestive of where this data comes from. You'll hear my colleague Rand Mitchell talk to you tonight about this, about how the Florida standards were planned differently. Before we go on, I want to show you a little video that is going to talk about some of this same data, but I want you to know that this is not just a Pasco County issue. We care about it because it's a Pasco County issue, but it's not just Pasco County. It's a state issue and it's a national issue. And so when you think about why this is happening even beyond Pasco County, why other districts, other states are thinking of changing the things that are happening in their schools, this will give you a peek into that. Compelling data there that suggests that even beyond Pasco County, there's definitely some reasons why this is the opportunity that we have to make some changes in what's happening in our schools. So I shared with you our vision, our mission for Pasco County Schools, if you will. To me, that's our heart. I shared with you our heart of what we want deep down inside for every single student in our schools. But I also shared with you that we're not there yet. And I had the data to prove it. We're not there yet. So we engaged in some planning. If that's where we want to be, if that's what we want for our students, what will we have to do to get there? And up until now, I have not mentioned the standards to you. And even as we began planning, we didn't talk about the standards. We talked about what classrooms needed to look like, what teaching needed to look like, and what opportunities for students needed to look like. So at the end of the day, the student owns the learning. When I talk in front of administrators, I have a great deal of knowledge I can share with them, but at the end of the day, if they don't take that knowledge back to their schools, it hasn't done any good. Administrators can stand in front of teachers and have lots and lots of knowledge to share, but at the end of the day, if their teachers don't take that back to the classroom, again, we have a lost opportunity. And lastly, at the end of the day, the teacher can have tons of knowledge and be very skilled and adept at their content and subject. But at the end of the day, if the student doesn't walk away with the learning, then again, we've missed an opportunity. So our planning has to be more than just the standards in the classroom. The planning has to be around how does the classroom look different to meet the needs of our students, our learners. So that's where the planning began, our vision, where we were, how we were going to fill that gap. The new standards became part of the opportunity to change the way a classroom looked. So I'm going to turn this over now to my colleague, Rayanne Mitchell, who's going to talk to you about where the standards came from and what they are.
So as you see on the screen before you, a definition of what the Florida standards, also known as the Common Core State Standards, what they are. They're basically just a clear, consistent, internationally benchmark set of standards for, at this point, English language arts and mathematics. And they provide a framework for what students need to know and be able to do to be successful as adults. As Ms. Hilton shared with you, the difference in these standards and previous standards is that instead of starting with kindergarten and what kids come in with, we started with what we want our kids to achieve at the end of schooling, and we built backwards. Very thoughtfully, though, we know that kindergartners can only handle certain things. It's kind of like a child learning to walk. You can try as you will to get them to stand and do that, and you can provide opportunities for them, but they may not be ready. So at kindergarten, first, and second grade, we were very, very thoughtful and careful about that. But as we go up in the grades, we are really pushing kids hard. We've increased the rigor. We've also increased the support so that kids can be successful. So you'll notice that framework piece. That gives us the structure, if you will, to build our curriculum and our instructional materials around. Right now, 45 states are implementing the Common Core State Standards in some way, shape, or form. In Florida, as Mr. Browning mentioned, we've added some standards. We've also added some language around the standards specific to Florida. Other states have done similar things. Some states have adopted only in one content area. They're adopting assessments or they're not adopting assessments. That's up to the state. A little bit of background about the Common Core State Standards. Sometimes we get calls in our office from families who are concerned that this is a way for the federal government to get into our classrooms. And we want to assure you that the Common Core State Standards were initiated by two groups, the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers. And they had very, very clear principles in mind when they initiated this endeavor. The first was that they wanted kids to be college and career ready, which is what we want for our students in Pasco County as well. They wanted to make sure the standards were based on solid research. And that means that the people who develop the standards are educational experts. They're people who study kids and learning and pedagogy and teaching, and they were able to build those standards to ensure that our kids would be successful. And even more important than that, in my opinion, is that practice evidence, which implies that our teachers have the opportunity to inform those standards. The standards were actually open for a very long time for people to be able to provide feedback, and many of our teachers, even here in Pasco County, provided very specific feedback about those standards, what it felt like to teach from them in the classroom, what their kids were able to handle, the scope and sequence to ensure that their kids were ready for the next level. And so our teachers had a big hand in that, and the developers of the standards listened to them. There are fewer standards than we've had previously. If you remember the Sunshine State Standards, that document was about this thick. It had many, many, many standards, and as a classroom teacher, you felt like sometimes you were just touching on topics and only spending a little bit of time. We call it going a mile wide and only an inch deep. And so sometimes our students didn't get to mastery. And as you notice from our data that Ms. Hilton shared with you, our kids were not as successful as we would have liked for them to have been. What we've learned is that to get to that deep understanding, we have to pick the most important things to teach and to teach those things really well, to teach them deeply and to make sure that kids really understand and that they become part of them. So there are fewer standards. Those standards are also higher. As Mr. Browning said to you earlier tonight, your kids are going to come home tired. They sometimes might even come home frustrated. And that's okay. At school, we're supporting them to ensure that they are successful and they have all of the supports around them to be able to tackle a harder, more challenging curriculum. And we also want you to encourage them at home as well, but not by doing their homework for them or telling them they don't have to do it, but instead by saying, hey, let's sit down together and talk about this. What can I do to help you? Maybe find resources for them to help support their learning and to let them know that part of growing as a learner is to have hard things to tackle and do. And we want to make sure our kids build up that endurance to be able to handle that, because in life, things are going to be hard. They're going to be in college, hopefully. They're going to have jobs and careers. They're going to have lots of challenges to tackle in their lives. And the third statement, the standards are clearer. As these standards were being written, they wanted to make sure that there was no question about what a standard meant, so that a teacher knew exactly what that standard implied. And our teachers in Pasco County have been spending a lot of time this fall and the spring, we call it unwrapping the standards, where they actually sit in groups and they work through, what does this mean for our kids? What do our kids need to know, understand, and do to be successful with this standard? And our teachers are growing in their knowledge. They're not all there yet, but they're definitely spending time in conversation, they're talking to their colleagues, they're learning about the standard so that they can inform their teaching. And finally, I think probably our most important bullet on this slide is that there is tons and tons of local flexibility within the Common Core State Standards, probably more so than Pasco County and Florida have seen in a really long time. If you look back to just a year or two or 3 years ago, our teachers were bound to a set of materials that our state made us choose from. And we were expected to teach those materials with fidelity, regardless of where our kids were developmentally, or even if we knew that a kid would learn better a different way, we kind of had a lockstep system for how we were teaching. Now our teachers have a lot of flexibility. They know what the end goal is and what their kids need to achieve, but they're able to choose instructional strategies and materials to help those children be successful. They're also able to slow down their pace or quicken up their pace as they need to as kids gain mastery in the standards. And the very last one, there's lots and lots of opportunities for teacher judgment. Our teachers are right now engaging in an instructional materials adoption process, which is allowing them to review materials for English language arts and mathematics. And it is amazing to watch those teachers sitting around tables, talking to publishers, asking really hard questions of them because they don't want to trust that a publisher knows their kids or knows what their kids need to be taught. They want to be really critical consumers and be able to say, yep, this is the right material because it offers flexibility, because I'm able to make some critical decisions for my students to help them to be successful. And our teachers are doing a really good job of making sure that they are selecting materials that are going to help our kids to be able to handle the rigor of the curriculum. You have a very attractive, colorful brochure in front of you. Everybody hold it up so I know that you got one. This is kind of your skinny guide, if you will, to the Common Core State Standards. Our communications department identified 10 key areas regarding the Common Core State Standards that we think that are important things for you to know. And I know from experience that if we do not open that brochure while we're in this room, chances are it is going to go in the bottom of your purse, on the floorboard of your car, or possibly in a garbage can. So to ensure that that doesn't happen, I want you to crack open that brochure, and we're going to look at just a couple of the points that are inside of it. Look at bullet number 3. It says the Common Core State Standards are not a curriculum and do not tell teachers what to teach. I'm sorry, how to teach. Standards are the what. They describe our overarching goal. They tell us clearly what kids need to know and be able to do to be successful. That's what the standards give us. They give us that framework. Curriculum and our instruction are the how. That's the part our teachers and our school system have control over. And that is really our teaching methodology. When a teacher's in the classroom and he or she are working with their students, probably other than the parents in this room, that classroom teacher knows those kids best of all. They know exactly when to push them a little harder. They know exactly when to pull back just a little bit. And they can watch their facial expressions and know exactly what kids need from them. And this is what we're doing locally here in Pasco County, in our school district, and in our schools. We're able to determine what those curriculum materials are. Look at number 9. It's in fuchsia. The Common Core State Standards delve deeper into core concepts. And I touched on this a little bit earlier, but I want to make sure you understand that rather than going a mile wide and an inch deep and getting just a little bit about a lot of things, we're instead going deeper into concepts so that kids really grasp them well. When I was a teacher years ago, we used to do instructional units, similar but not the same as what we do now. And I remember spending 6 weeks on dinosaurs. I loved dinosaurs. I had all kinds of really great things in my room about dinosaurs. And I think that that unit motivated my kids to want to learn. They loved coming to school. They loved learning about dinosaurs. But I'm pretty sure that probably out of that entire class, none of those kids became paleontologists or got a job in a museum working on dinosaurs. So that learning was probably not critical to those students' future lives. The learning that we're doing in our classrooms today is more focused on that. We want to make sure that kids see explicit connections between what they're learning in their classrooms and how it's going to help them as they grow as adults. We're going to watch another video. We've been talking to you now for about 45 minutes, which is a lot, more than we hope our classroom teachers are talking in their classrooms with their students. And this video is actually an overview of the Common Core State Standards. And what I would like for you to do is, as you're watching this video, I would like for you to identify who developed the standards, how they were developed, what they are, and why Pasco County and Florida adopted the standards. Back.
For decades, we've been debating how to improve schools in the United States. This has been born from a real
classroom as instructional tools, we're also using a video tonight to help you to solidify your learning. So I would like for you to take a moment, turn to someone near you, or if there's not someone near you, feel free to stretch your legs for just a minute, and share a belief that you came tonight with about the Common Core State Standards or the new Florida standards that has been either changed by the information we've given you, or maybe it's been solidified. You came with a belief and something we said lets you know that that was pretty accurate. So take just a minute to process your learning so far. I have a question for you. Does anybody know why you cut off the end of the ham before you bake it? Anybody who's not a Pasco County educator? Anybody know? You don't bake ham? Do you know? That's exactly right, because that's what our mothers did. And the way that old wives' tale goes, a little girl went in the kitchen and she asked her mom at Christmas, why do you cut off the end of the ham before you stick it in the pan? And she's like, I have no idea. My mom did it, so I do it. So she goes and asks her grandmother the same question. Her grandmother says, I don't know. My mom did it, so I do it too. And she asked her great-grandmother, and she, of course, explained that ovens were a little smaller, pans were a little smaller, we weren't quite as indulgent with our eating, and they cut off that end of the ham because it's the only way they could get it in the pan. That's kind of how teaching has been for a very long time. I taught the way the teacher before me taught. I taught the way my colleagues taught. I didn't always question why I did the things I did. Why do I write the date on the board every morning? Why do I have to have students do daily oral language? I think that as school leaders and district leaders and classroom teachers, we have to ask those questions regularly of our work. Is this something that's going to help our kids to be successful? And if it is, we hang on tight to it. And there are lots of good practices that have been around a long time that are very solid and are very grounded in research. But there are also a lot of practices we do just because someone before us did them. And that's not a good reason to hang on to it. Having kids sit in rows. A lot of our schools have been set up that way for a very long time. And I think that my interning teacher told me, well, that's how you get kids to behave. You don't want them sitting next to each other. They might pinch each other or bother each other. We want them not to copy from each other's papers. If you'll notice in Pasco County classrooms today, you'll see lots of spaces for collaboration. Desks pushed together, kids sitting in circles, tables, so that kids can have opportunities to talk to their peers about their learning and to talk to their teachers. Mr. Browning mentioned early that statement about who owns the learning. Our kids have to own the learning. We can no longer be the expert standing in front of the classroom dumping knowledge into their brains. Because frankly, the knowledge we give them is going to be irrelevant by the time they become adults. We have to teach them to be good thinkers and to be critical listeners and to be able to access information so that they can be successful in the world that we can't even fathom right now. We're going to switch now. We've talked a little bit about the standards and what they are, and now probably the part that you came most to hear is what's happening in Pasco County. What does it look like? What does it sound like? What does it feel like? So we know that we can't continue to do things the way we've always done them, like the ham story, and expect different results. If we want that data that Ms. Hilton showed us from 2011 to be different when our kids graduate, we're going to have to change the way we teach and the way kids learn to ensure that that happens. So we want to make sure that we are embracing a new way of teaching and learning. And that's regardless of what standards we're using. We know that kids learn differently. We know that they have technology in their hands 24/7 and that they're used to really bright, shiny, engaging kinds of things. So sitting in a classroom in a chair with a pencil listening to a teacher talk is not what motivates them any longer. I would like for you to look at a portrait of a student who meets the standards and read those bulleted items to yourself. Ms. Hilton mentioned these earlier tonight when she talked about a college and career ready student. So look at those and see if any of those are things that you wouldn't want for your child. If you notice out of that big long list, building strong content knowledge is only one aspect. We of course want our kids to be good learners and to know lots of things, but frankly, they can get a lot of the things that they need to know on Google. So we can't focus all of our attention on just facts. We have to make sure that they're also independent. Raise your hand if you want your kid to be independent and move out of your house one day. Okay. We also want them to be able to be responsive to the environment around them. Kids spend a lot of time using technology. I was at a family reunion recently, and everyone in the room was playing Words with Friends with people who were in the same room, but they were all staring at their device, no eye contact, no conversation. And we want to make sure that our kids are engaged in the world around them. We want to make sure that they can comprehend and critique. And tonight I mentioned to you about being critical consumers of what you read on the internet. That's what critiquing is all about. It's about looking at something and being able to determine, is that fact or is it not? Is it something I believe in and why? What evidence is there to tell me that this is the truth? We want them to be able to use technology and use it well. If you've ever done a Google search, if you did one tonight for Common Core State Standards, you would notice that there are pages and pages and pages of references. Many of those are bogus. So we want to make sure that we teach our kids how to determine what's real and what's not. And as Vanessa mentioned earlier, we want them to be understanding of other perspectives and cultures. Our world is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Our kids can Skype with someone in China in a matter of 10 seconds. So we want to make sure that they understand all the different places and all the different people that are in the world and the challenges that they face. I'm going to talk to you tonight very quickly about two misconceptions that are around the standards and the instructional shifts. The first one is that literature is no longer taught, only informational text. That is not true. We have our instructional shifts here, and you notice that shift number one is balancing information and literary text, which means that we try to do both in all of our classrooms. The rest of the shifts are also listed there for you. In elementary school, you will notice that your child is going to be exposed to and engaging with about 50% fiction text, which are like stories, and about 50% informational text, which are like magazine articles, newspapers, procedure manuals, things like that that are factual. As they move up through the grades into middle school and high school, they will then be exposed to a lot more informational text. And the reason for that is that mostly they're going to receive their narrative or nonfiction text in their English language arts class, which is only 1/6 of their school day. But you'll also notice they're engaging in text in mathematics and science and social studies and technical subjects. And most of those are going to be informational text because they're going to be accessing information. We want to make sure that we are using an integrated model of literacy. And you'll see that hopefully in every single one of our schools, which means that teaching reading or having kids read doesn't just happen in reading class anymore. It happens throughout the school day. And we make sure that we make purposeful connections to that. You'll notice that some schools identify a strategy that they're focusing on, and you'll see that strategy modeled in math and in science and in social studies so that kids see that that strategy is applicable, and no matter where they're at, it makes it become something that's part of them. And we want our kids to read widely and read closely. Reading widely obviously means reading lots and lots of different kinds of text. Different things excite different people. My husband loves to read magazines. I prefer to read books. That's okay, but we want to expose kids to as many different kinds of text as we can. But we also want to give them plenty of opportunities to dig deeply into the text they're reading, which means reading text multiple times, spending time. Remember earlier, even on this slide, I've underlined things. If you looked at my notes up there, I have highlights and notes all around them. That's how I digest information, and that's how I learn. As parents, we want and need your support to be able to help your students to be successful. Some ways that you can do that for us is to expose your kids to lots and lots of different kind of text. It can be text that you're looking at online, it can be the newspaper, it can be going to the public library, but spending time with your kids, and hopefully not all of that time at the kitchen table with lots of tears and frustration. Maybe on the back porch swing, or sitting on the couch together, or reading on Saturday morning instead of watching cartoons. Spending time reading and doing things that kids will see as valuable and fun and interesting. Have fun with nonfiction in front of them. I told this story the other night, and sadly my dryer is still not fixed. But my husband has spent a lot of time lately working on our dryer. And he has searched on the internet to find all of these how-tos on how to fix a dryer. None of them have worked so far, but I think it's important for our kids to see us engaging in text and accessing information just like they do. Standard 10 is our enduring standard, and it says that read and comprehend complex literary and information text independently and proficiently. This is what we want for our students. We want them not to need us. We want them to be able to pick up any piece of material that they want to pick up and to be able to read that on their own without support. The best way to make that happen is to give them lots and lots and lots of practice. I'm going to quickly talk with you about the math misconception, one of them. This one is that problem-solving precision isn't necessary. Has anyone's child come home and said, at school I have to explain my thinking? Or they tell you the answer and they say, but I still have to explain why? We ask that a lot in our classrooms. Shift 4 is deep understanding. And if you notice the other shifts there, focus, coherence, fluency, application, and dual intensity, the one we're going to focus on tonight is deep understanding. And that's basically that students can understand a math concept, not just how to calculate an answer, and they're also able to apply that concept to various situations. They can problem solve, and we want to be sure that they're using efficient strategies. I'm sure you probably remember your children, and maybe even yourselves, when you were little and you were learning to multiply, and you drew all those little sticks and circles to make groups of 10. That works if you're doing 3 times 5. But it doesn't work so well if you're doing 75 times 350. That becomes an inefficient strategy. So as kids move through the continuum of learning, we want them to use efficient strategies that get them to the answer as quick as possible. And then for them to be able to share that learning. And that's that last bullet, that they can communicate math thinking orally and in writing. On the FCAT test, which is, of course, this will be our last year for that, but we don't know what our new test will look like, students are asked to explain and communicate in writing about their mathematical understanding. That's a hard thing to do, so we want to support our kids in that. This slide shows you kind of those two pieces. The one on the left, the problem-solving piece. Our kids are generally pretty good at that. They can problem-solve. The hard part comes when we ask them to communicate it to us. In the video that we're going to watch at the very end, there's a teacher who does this magically. She has her kids explain their thinking, and then she has another student restate that and restate their understanding of that thinking so that they're all transferring that learning from student to student while they're working through it. And how you can promote deep understanding at home? Talk to your kids about math. One of our math specialists commented that it is socially acceptable to say I hate math or I'm not good at math, but no one ever wants to say I'm not a good reader or I don't like to read. We want to make sure our kids realize that math is something important and something good and something valuable and that they can use it in their life. So advocate time your child needs to learn key math. Find ways to infuse key math into your daily life. If you're at the grocery store or at Macy's and you are trying to figure out what a discount is, have your child figure it out for you. Say, hey, canned goods are buy one, get one. So how much does that make each can? Or if you're, of course, at Macy's shopping for shoes, you can say, shoes are 25% off. How much is that going to be today? And then kids will see that connection between the things they learn in school and the things that they're going to use in life. Finally, I want to share with you some family-friendly resources that are available to you. The one in the top left corner is called NSYNC Education, and this is a free resource to all of our families in Pasco County, and it's a plethora of good information. You can use that search engine to be able to identify specific concepts, specific standards, specific grade levels that your child is working on that you want to support them with at home. It gives you lots of prompts to help you to ask questions about what they're learning during the school day. Some others that are listed, everything that we shared with you tonight is on the Pasco County website. We update that regularly to ensure that the most current information is there for you. A few that I especially like, if you have not visited the PTA website, they are amazing. Very, very family-friendly resources there. Obviously, the Parent Toolkit, which is sponsored by NBC and Pearson, is a really great one. What I love about that one is it's grade-specific, so you can actually go to the grade level that your child is in and see all kinds of information about the standards there. One quick reminder before we finish up, you have your QR code on your agenda. There's also a place at the very bottom if you'd prefer just to write a question. During this last video, we're going to be walking around and collecting those questions from you so that we can answer those at the end. We are almost finished. This last video that you're going to watch is actually a glimpse into Pasco County Schools. You're going to see our teachers and your students engaged in a new way of teaching and learning.
Pasco County Schools are fully committed to providing students with learning that is rigorous and relevant to their world and prepares them for the future. The Common Core State Standards are the vehicle that allows us this opportunity to align our student expectations with other school districts in Florida, our country, and even the world. However, we believe that the standards alone will not transform teaching or learning in Pasco County Schools. Our students and teachers also need high-quality resources to engage in this work. As a result, teachers are currently involved in the selection of standards-driven curriculum through our instructional materials adoption process for English language arts and mathematics. The thoughtful decisions made by these groups of dedicated educators will give all teachers the support and resources they need to address the standards. Currently, our teachers are analyzing the standards in order to develop units of instruction that meet the unique needs of Pasco County students, addressing what they need to know, understand, and do, ensuring that by the time they graduate, students are college, career, and life ready.
Remember that I want to know which piece caused the change in the behavior. So we're not just putting random things together to try to come up with something. We're trying to figure out what's making it do that. The first one was an aggressive robot that drives faster as it gets closer to something, a scared robot that drives away from things, a confused robot that drives in circles, and a robot that lets you use the force to control how it moves with your hand.
One of the things I love about this is that it really is, allows them to think creatively, and I'm not funneling them into one way of thinking. They get to challenge themselves and think outside of the box rather than using a textbook which directs them and tells them step by step, this is what you need to be thinking. They're figuring it out for themselves. It's very self-directed. And because of that, they're doing a lot of problem solving. And they may come to the table with a thought, but as they work with the Cubelet, it challenges the way they think, and they have to restructure the way they think, and that's powerful learning. That's the strongest kind of learning you can have, because it's self-created. When you create your own learning, that's when you have your best understanding.
We know that intentional planning leads to intentional teaching, which results in rigorous and relevant learning. That is why support is being provided to teachers through ongoing professional development, curriculum planning teams, the adoption of aligned instructional materials, and standards-based assessments.
Rose, did you find anything good?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What'd you find?
Charted in 1866 in New York by Henry Berg and Shelter.
Great. How'd you find that?
We went to the mines. And then
kids in Phobos.
Why'd you use the mine?
Because that's like a bunch of research for kids and stuff.
And today my students are researching an organization, the ASPCA. The reason we are doing that is because our unit in reading is all about achievements, and we decided that we are going to achieve something by donating to a charity that we chose. So before they do that, they are going to find out about that charity, what it is that they need, and they're creating an article that they're going to explain to the reader what the ASPCA is all about.
Ruby, what are you going to do with all this information now that you have it? This, the stuff from your encyclopedia, the stuff from articles, what are you going
to
do with that?
To make it into paragraphs, and those would become
articles? An article? You're writing an article? Nice. What is your article going to be about?
About, what the ASPCA does.
So now, when you walk into your child's classroom, whether elementary or secondary, you will see a clear focus on a new kind of learning. This includes opportunities for varied types of communication, peer collaboration, understanding of other perspectives and cultures, the use of digital technology, and real-world problem solving, while developing critical literacy and math skills necessary for thriving in today's world.
It's kind of like a graph. Make a table or a chart. I wanted the students to identify and analyze proportional relationships. I also wanted them to make connections between equivalent fractions and proportionality. I intentionally planned for standards of mathematical practice number 1, which is making sense and persevering through the problem, and number 3, which is constructing viable arguments and critiquing the reasons of others, where they actually, the students that got up, they were able to critique them if they didn't agree or they agreed with them.
And there were easier ways in cross-simplifying, like for 3, we did 12 sixteenths and 6 eighths, because we know that 12 and 6 are half, and then 8 and 16 are half.
During both the Do Now and the High Cognitive Demand task, I had the students actually get up and justify their answer, which was a form of formative assessment.
It's in a proportion because 1 half would be half, half would be half, and 5 tenths is half of 10.
I'm also walking around the room, constantly looking at their work and listening to their conversations when they're talking to their shoulder partners. I do a lot of making sense of what someone else said. So I'll ask them, what did, make sense of what so-and-so just said, so that they can actually summarize in their own words what someone had shared.
What'd she say, Anthony?
She said that what she technically said is that 5 over 10 would be half of 10, 5 is half of 10, and then 1 is half of 2.
Okay, so Trey, how is that a proportion?
Because they're both equal, and the definition of proportion is an equation stating that 2 ratios are equal.
We have a solid plan for implementation of the Common Core state standards, and supports are in place. All employees in Pasco County Schools, from our support staff to our administrative teams, our hardworking teachers, district staff, school board members, and our superintendent are fully committed to this work. Together, we will fulfill our promise that every child is college, career, and life ready.
So as we answer some of these questions, you can, of course, we'll take additional questions as well. This question is, how would a child in K through third grade wanting to learn more fit in with the Common Core? And what I think you're asking is, when students need to accelerate, how does that work? And that has really less to do with the standards and more to do with our philosophy in Pasco County, which is to provide for acceleration opportunities for students. And so the Common Core provides outcomes for the end of the year, but of course, as Ms. Mitchell even mentioned, as students are ready or need extra support, the teaching and the teacher makes decisions on how to provide acceleration opportunities, and then also how to provide extra support for students that they might need in particular areas. So support comes in a couple of different ways. It might be because kids are struggling, but it might also be because kids need more challenge in order to be fully engaged in school. There are a couple of questions that are school-specific or teacher-specific, and so I'll answer them just broadly, but I realize I might not be answering your specific question. And it's a question about why homework is not counting in kindergarten. And That's a real school-specific and actually teacher-specific question, but broadly, let me say that students need an opportunity to practice, just like you need an opportunity to practice. When I got a new phone, I certainly need an opportunity to practice before I could make a call or check an email. When you learn something new, you need an opportunity to practice before it's time to be put on the spot. And so our students see that opportunity as well. And so while I'm not in that particular situation, my thoughts would be that students need that opportunity to practice and not everything has to be graded. There's also a question about why we're waiting until third grade for increased rigor. And so and we did have some mention of that, but let me say that we're not waiting until third grade for increased rigor. But what we are waiting for, or what we're hesitant about in kindergarten and first grade in particular, is increasing the complexity of text as we are starting in second through and on up the grades. And so what research would tell us is that it's very important to create opportunities for students to learn and have mastery and foundational reading skills, especially in kindergarten and first grade, and that the focus of our instruction should be on those foundational skills, and that it is not as beneficial to those young students in kindergarten and first grade to increase the text complexity. And so when we refer to the rigor increasing in second and third and on up, that really was what, that just to clarify that point, is that we're not increasing the text complexity for students who are at that level. Of course, students who are accelerated, it is refer back to my previous answer in terms of what their needs, but the expectations and outcomes for each grade level are more developmentally appropriate at that age. Here's a question about what kind of learning is deemed critical, and I'm assuming that is referenced back to the fact that we are teaching a set of core standards. And as Ms. Mitchell referred to, when she was a teacher, she had a whole unit on dinosaurs. When I was a principal, I had teachers who had whole units on bears. That's not critical content. The critical content really has to do with the study that the writers of the Common Core and the folks who had input into the Common Core found that the most successful states had in their standards, the most successful countries out there had in their standards. So it's not going to be everything. If it's everything, then our standards end up being a mile wide and an inch deep again. Of course, in our state, we also have content standards, Next Generation Sunshine State standards in science, social studies, and technical areas that add to our curriculum. So these Florida standards are just in English, language arts, and mathematics, and they're the core set of concepts that the writers of the Common Core found would increase the likelihood of our students being college, career, and life ready. There's a question about us conducting parent meetings due to parental reaction to the Common Core, and that's not really the reason why we planned these. This was our opportunity to speak to parents, the community, the public, really about some of the misconceptions that are out there, and what we were doing in Pasco County. So you know, tonight was not just about the standards. It was about our mission and vision for education in this county, as well as what we're doing to implement in our county. The Florida standards was only part of it. This is our opportunity to engage with our community, find out what your concerns are, find out what your issues are, and talk to you in just a very open way about what we're doing to change education in Pasco County. And part of that has to do with the standards. There's also a question about why there's pushback to the Common Core. And you know, I can't necessarily say why there's been pushback. I think some of that is created from the misconceptions that are out there. I think some of that is because there is a lot on the internet that you can read about the Common Core, and some of it is research-based. It's, it's based on the actual standards, and some of it is not. And I think that there are some political pieces to the Common Core that are just don't play into our implementation here in Pasco County. Do we have some additional ones? You have a mic.
Yeah, let me ask a couple of these. One of the questions that was asked is, with the new standards being implemented, are there or will there be considerations to students in ESE, students with ADHD and so on? Will there be accommodations to help those students keep up with the new standards? The answer to that is yes. Certainly, really nothing changes. If they are seeking a general diploma and they have a 504 plan, then they will get the same accommodations and will be expected to meet the new standards. Certainly, through the PLC process, they will identify those kids. They will provide the supports that those kids need in our schools. One of the things that we really want to do, and one of the things we have done, is we have moved supports closer to the schools and actually closer to the classrooms. That's where the action is in this district. It's not at the district office, it's at the classrooms. So we want to be able to make sure that our teachers are getting the supports they need, and what I should say is that our students are getting the supports they need through those teachers. So yes, those kids that are pursuing a general education or diploma will in fact be given with the 504 the accommodations that they need. One of the questions would like to know specifics. Arm's not long enough. How different our standards are prior to the Florida state standards? Well, I think for the reasons that we've already listed tonight, these standards are more rigorous. These standards, there's fewer of them. One of the concerns that we have is with the current standards that we're teaching, teachers, I think, feel overwhelmed because there are so many standards. There are fewer. We can go deeper into the standards that the state has adopted. There was a question about developmental research used to justify standards. I cannot give you specifics to this question. I wasn't there when they developed the standards, but I will tell you that, as our presentation mentioned tonight, there were teachers, there were education experts and professionals involved with the development of these standards, and they are age appropriate. The nice thing about it too is that local districts and classroom teachers have the flexibility to watch each one of these kids. We do not want to add any undue pressure or burden on the kids that are in these classrooms. However, with rigorous standards, even in kindergarten, you will see more rigor that the child is needing to be faced with in order to meet those standards. So it's a balance that we go through. And as moms and dads, when you start seeing your kids coming home a little stressed or something, talk to them. Talk to them. Talk to your child's teacher. Let's make sure that, because as we've stated in the presentation, we're very concerned about the child from K-12, but we're also concerned about the child after graduation. We want to make sure that those child's social, emotional needs are being met. And it's not that we're just cramming information into their head or attempting to cram information into that student's head. That's why we say they need to own the learning. They need to be engaged in their learning and understand what the connection is between what they're learning and real life. It does start in kindergarten. You have to start in kindergarten, and that's the reason that we are really focused, particularly on the literacy piece. Why it slays me how we have third graders that cannot read. That bothers me. That bothers me a lot. And so what we are doing as a district is strategically looking and focusing on K-1 and looking at the literacy skills that we are teaching our kids so that we can quit passing kids to second grade and to third grade and to fourth grade without having the literacy skills that they need to be successful. One of the questions on here was, how do we ensure that we're not just teaching to the test like FCAT? One of the things that I have been very vocal about with the folks in Tallahassee, including the Commissioner of Education, is that we do not need another FCAT in Florida. What we need is a nationally normed assessment. that is going to assess nationally normed standards. The problem that we've gotten ourselves into in Florida is that we have created this homegrown assessment called the FCAT. And over the long haul, it has changed, and it has changed multiple times. The standards have changed over and over again over the last, I think it's 36 changes to the standards in the last 24 months. And it's like hitting a moving target. What we need to make sure of is the assessment, which will be announced next month by the Florida Department of Education, which will be the assessment that will be assessed next spring, this time next year, on the new standards. One of the things we hope to do as a district is as soon as we learn more about that assessment, we want to communicate that out to moms and dads. One of the things that came out of one of these community meetings from a mom, actually a number of moms and dads, was a parent newsletter. And it's like, hello, why haven't we done this before? And what we're going to do is when you register your children for school in August, we will be collecting email addresses. And we're going to be having those email addresses for the sole purpose, that the only purpose, is to communicate with parents about things that are going on in their school and their school system. And one of the things that we want to be able to do is put out at least a monthly newsletter to moms and dads just about things going on in their school and the school district. So we'll be collecting that information as we start registering the kids in August. I hope that we will move away from teaching to the test. And I'm confident that the way that we're changing the instruction in our classrooms, that we won't, there won't be a need to be teaching to a test. It will truly be assessing what these kids have learned over the last year of instruction. There was a question about, is the, quote, meet requirement sections in eSimpler updated with Common Core? Yeah, absolutely. You know more about it than I do.
Referring to is is the child meeting their graduation requirements, and those graduation requirements are unique to each cohort of students, so each grade of students who come through. So while we do anticipate that when we have an assessment aligned on whole assessment system aligned to the Common Core, we'll need to update that, but that's actually related more to graduation requirements than specific standards. I have a question related to, or that says, will classic literature be taught like Shakespeare, poetry, Beowulf? And we tapped into that just a little bit in this presentation. We definitely will still be teaching classic literature. The misconception is that that's being pulled from the curriculum. The truth is that there have been times, there have been curriculum materials that we have had. When I was an elementary principal, I had curriculum materials for kindergarten that did not have a lick of nonfiction, not one piece. It was only stories. And so how do I teach students to gain knowledge from text if I'm not using any nonfiction or true text with them? So the idea that we increase students' access and teaching with nonfiction was really important, especially at the elementary level when the emphasis really was on fictional text. And so, but you hear that balance. It truly should be a balance. So for every narrative text, story, poem that they read, they should also be reading a piece of nonfiction, a true piece of text. When you get into the older grades, it should, the narrative focus should start to diminish because their classes become much more focused and targeted in particular areas. So, for example, I have a student in my house who's a junior, and one period of her day is an English class. The other periods of her day are chemistry, biology, U.S. history, 3D art. During those times, I do expect her to be engaging in nonfiction text. I expect her to be learning about chromatography and cell theory and things like that. And so that's why the increase in informational text occurs at the secondary level. But that English class, that literature class, still should be engaging in classic literature at the appropriate level. What you may see is that the text increases in text complexity more so than it did before in order to meet the rigor of the standards.
Let me also add to that if I can, please. One of the questions we keep getting is the use of, one of the myths out there is the use of inappropriate materials or texts in classrooms. I've been on Facebook. I have a Facebook account. I've seen the post out there by folks that are saying, and also send the link out there about what some school district is doing out in Idaho, and that they're using inappropriate texts. Now, what do I mean by inappropriate? What I mean by inappropriate is something that's not appropriate for our school system in Pasco County. That's what I mean by inappropriate. Well, you said it's subjective. Well, yeah, it is subjective, but I believe that the teachers in our district understand where the line is. Because if they don't, the folks that are in the classrooms with them, they do. And I have been very, very candid about this, that there is no place in our classrooms for inappropriate materials. Period, new paragraph. Most every time, almost without exception, when I've seen the post out to Facebook about the use of inappropriate materials, has been at least, fortunately, referenced from some other state. Actually, the State Board of Education a couple of months ago actually voted not to include the appendices to the Common Core state standards as the resources used in Florida classrooms. So it's not part of the, quote, Common Core. They've said we're not using those as the official resource list. That resource list has some questionable materials on there. But the beauty about what we're doing is that it gives us the flexibility, gives teachers the flexibility in the classroom to choose the appropriate materials for your students. So the line of thinking is, if you believe something's inappropriate, you need to talk to your child's teacher. If you're not satisfied, you talk to the principal. And eventually you end up getting to me if you still think that it's inappropriate, and then we'll have those discussions. But I just want to make sure that everybody understood that the use of sexually explicit materials is inappropriate in our classrooms. That is absolutely inappropriate in our classrooms. Quick story, we had a teacher at one of our high schools that was actually using that type of material, unrelated to the standards. Having kids in the classroom read this out loud, section by section. We found out about it. The teacher's no longer working in the district. They chose to resign, which was the best choice of course of action for that teacher. Because it's not tolerated, it's inappropriate for our community. But we're given the flexibility to make those decisions, okay?
Additional questions? I have a question. Are teachers, you'll like this one, are teachers hired by Pasco County out of college ready to teach in this style? And the answer is not always. But the good part is that we have strong partnerships with local colleges, and so we have a partnership with St. Leo University, we have a partnership with University of South Florida, in order to help them align their curriculum and their standards with what we want from the graduates coming out of their schools. In addition, we have, as part of our partnership with USF, we have many, many interns placed in Pasco County schools. And so that opportunity gives us a chance to really be part of the training of those teachers. So that's a work in progress. Another question is, how do these standards better prepare students for the SAT and ACT? And that's a pretty easy one. The ACT and SAT are measures of college readiness. So as our instruction increases in rigor and we are preparing students for college, career, and life readiness, then we anticipate that they'll do better and better on assessments like that. As a side note, those assessments will most likely go through their own set of revisions to be aligned to more rigorous standards. There is also a question related to what are the expectations for physical education teachers to integrate Common Core into their curriculum and what type of support and resources are going to be available for those teachers. And so for all of our teachers in Pasco County, there is an expectation that we align instruction to the Common Core or the Florida standards. And what I mean by that is for PE teachers or for art teachers or for music teachers, as an example, to include, as appropriate, text. So if my daughter, as I mentioned, is in an art class, then there might be some text that she reads about an artist. There might be a reflection that someone's written about a particular piece of art that is part of then the learning about that type of art. You can use different media as sources for students to write from. So there might be some changes that happen in teaching, but what we're doing to assist teachers with that is, as much as we mentioned earlier, we're bringing teacher teams together in order to help align our curriculum materials and curriculum resources with these standards. So actually this spring, in regards to special area teachers in elementary schools and as well as fine arts and music and physical education teachers in secondary schools, we are bringing together groups of teachers to help us rewrite those curriculum resources and be an assistance to those teachers.
I feel like it's a telethon. Two questions. Please describe the data collection procedures expected to be in place, the types of data to be collected, and what is being done to ensure a student's privacy is not violated. Let me answer that one. Data collection has been a big issue as it relates, particularly as the state started talking about Common Core. A lot of times what will happen is that part of the misconception out there is they have this umbrella, what I call Common Core, and underneath the umbrella there were standards, there was assessments, and data collection. That's not Common Core. Common Core are standards only. The data collection piece and the assessments piece is not Common Core. But a lot of folks want to tuck it back up in there. Now, let me get to the question. The question is talking about the data collection procedures that are expected to be in place. We have been collecting data on students forever. When we were all in school, we had data collected on us. All student data is protected by FERPA. That's an acronym for the federal law that protects the collection of student data. I will also tell you that the state legislature is also considering a proposal that will tighten the restrictions on the collection of that data even more. They start meeting next week in Tallahassee. You can go online and check the status of these particular bills. I do not think that student data should be given out to anybody other than the folks that are in the school system to make sure that that we're meeting the progress of our students. So that data, the types of data would be the normal data that we would collect, obviously names, addresses, birth dates. We have assessment data, whatever the federal law and the state law requires us to collect, we will be collecting it. But I think the important thing is that we hold that data very, very, very tightly. The second question was, will teachers' materials be available for public review so we can ensure only factual information and not a political agenda is being taught? We are going through the reading adoption now and mathematics. The district.
What about us?
What? Well, if you'd like to read it, I mean, that's why we're going through this process. The materials, the resources are in fact open. There have been a number of people that have asked for copies of the textbook. We loan them a copy of the textbook. That's fine. It's open. The entire process for reading adoption and the mathematics adoption is open. It's an open process. And as the public is certainly willing to sit in and be involved with that process as much as law allows them. The selection of instructional materials is regulated by state statute through the Department of Education. But again, the locals have the flexibility to choose the text and the materials that are best suited for our classrooms. There are teachers that are involved with that process. There are administrators. We have publishers that will come in and present materials to us based on criteria that we're looking for. And then this committee will make recommendations to the superintendent, and then the superintendent will then make that recommendation to the school board. Yes, ma'am. Well, I hope it hasn't just been one point of view up to this point. We will use text, but what we're doing is what you're going to find in the district is that the textbooks, where they used to be central in the classroom, they used to be central, and quite honestly, this is my analogy, but everything revolved around the textbook. We're getting away from that. The textbook is a resource, along with a lot of other resources that individual teachers may select in order to teach to that standard, depending on what the standard is and depending on what the subject is, as well as depending on the age of the student. So I would like to think that when our teachers who are professionals in the classroom, whether they're using a textbook or whether they're using some other resource, that they are being balanced. I will tell you that under the new scheme, that the students will be much more engaged doing their own research, finding out what the different points or positions are regarding an issue. That's how we teach our kids to critically think. Are we going to tell them that this position is right and this position is wrong? Absolutely not. We won't do that. We won't do that. Because we believe that the kids need to think and let them tell us why they think that position is right and why this position is wrong. We do that every day as adults. I could throw out some really hot button issues. I mean, medical marijuana, for one, it's a current topic going on right now. I had a big debate in Tampa. We could take a show of hands, not going to. But we all have differing opinions on medical marijuana in Florida, don't we? And we all have our rationale, our reasons why we would support medical marijuana or why we would oppose medical marijuana. So the same thing's going to take place in our classrooms, because we want our kids to start thinking. We want our kids to start problem solving, because when they're in the workplace, as even though I'm the superintendent of the 11th largest district in Florida, 54th in the nation, there is rarely a day that goes by that I single-handedly make a decision. Why? Because there are people that are surrounding me that have more information than I have, that have information that I need, and I'm going to be collaboratively working with them, trying to find out what the best decision is for that particular issue. That's real life. That's real life. And that's what we need to be teaching our kids, is to work collaboratively with people, to problem solve, to critically think, make decisions based on the facts and the information you've gathered. It's a good question. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
I have some additional ones.
Well, answer them.
So closely connected to that is a question about what about the use of references or resources online when using research as part of materials. And that has to be part of our teaching. You know, probably 30 years ago, we wouldn't have taught kids how to research on the internet, right? And so now that has to be part of what we do. And it includes how to evaluate sites, which sites to go to. We have a collection, if you will, of protected sites or vetted sites that our kids have entry to, especially at very young ages, because we don't want them to spend the majority of their time trudging through link after link after link. And so we have some vetted sites on a database that we call the Mind that allows students to quickly go to educational research sites like National Geographic and things like that, where we know that the information is very factual and will be closely related to what students are wanting to find in order to engage in deeper learning. That's part of our teaching. We can't take that for granted. This question says, if this year would be the last year of FCAT, do we still continue with FCAT rights for 4th, 8th, and 10th? And we would anticipate that would also, this would also be our last year of that. We would anticipate also that when we get a Common Core aligned or a Florida Standards aligned assessment, that writing would be integrated into reading as it is in the standards. So that is a pretty big change or difference, is that writing and reading are very integrated standards in these new standards, and they haven't been before, funny enough, even though reading and writing are pretty connected. And so we anticipate that our assessment would connect those as well. This next question is, how do Common Core standards differ from county to county? Hillsborough versus Pasco versus Pinellas. And so all of us, all of the 67 counties in the state of Florida now would be utilizing the new Florida standards. So we had the same benchmarks in mind, the same outcomes in mind for our students in English language arts and mathematics. We also, of course, are using the same Next Generation Sunshine State standards for science, social studies, and those technical subjects. And so you would see great similarities in content. Where you might see differences is in materials that they've chosen to utilize, and also teaching strategies that just as in our county from teacher to teacher and school to school may be different also between those counties as teachers plan to meet the unique needs of their students.
Yes, ma'am. I don't think Florida received any money for adopting Common Core state standards. Pasco has not seen any money other than through our normal legislative appropriation. Any cost to prepare for Common Core or Florida standards have been borne by the districts. I know of no money. Of course, I'm not in Tallahassee, but I know of no money. I assume like from publishers or what have you.
Federal funding.
No. The only federal funding that I believe that was ever set aside was to help determine, had something to do with the consortia, the Smarter Balance, the park assessment. Florida was the fiscal agent for park. We have pulled out of that consortia. So we are not involved with that anymore. Matter of fact, what Florida did is they actually went out with an RFQ or an RFP on the assessment. So we don't know what the assessment's going to be, and I don't think Tallahassee knows what it's going to be just yet. They're supposed to make that announcement next month. But we are not the fiscal agent for any of the assessments out there. Yes, sir. Well, let me just tell you that teaching is not like engineering. Got it. Certainly what this district has done, and I actually made the comment last night in an email about 11:30 that I sent to a teacher about professional development. We've probably provided more professional development as a district to our instructional staff in the last year than we have over the last 4 or 5 years. I see some nods of some administrators and some teachers. And the reason being is because we know that, well, when I became superintendent in November of 12, we did a district assessment on where we were with the implementation of Common Core. Just our self-assessment, we realized that we were probably, at best guess, 12 to 18 months behind where we needed to be in order for the beginning of school year 14-15, which is this coming August. 12 to 18 months, year to year and a half behind where we needed to be. Hindsight will tell you, will tell me, that we really, really pushed some teachers. We have pushed some administrators. And we knew that we had to move more quickly than normal in order to get us where we needed to be. I wish that we were afforded more time to have done it more gradually, because we've known about these standards since 2010. We've known about these standards since 2010. That's when the State Board of Education first adopted these standards. It wasn't until just recently that even the governor himself opens them back up for public comment. That's where they got about 20,000 comments, and that's where they came up with other 98 changes to these standards. Our teachers, to their credit, have been spectacular. They have stepped up to the plate. Our principals and our assistant principals have been terrific. Had they all done this willingly? Not so much. But at the end of the day, they all understand what's at risk, what's at stake. We fund our professional development through our grants, federal money that we may get. We also fund it through the school district's budget every year. As long as I'm superintendent, professional development has got to be key. It's got to be central to everything that we do. Our teachers said they wanted to be treated like professionals. And I politely looked at them and I said, that's fine, but you must act like professionals. And so part of that commitment that I've made to our teachers is the fact that we need to provide the professional development that they need to be able to teach in their classrooms and provide a great, great education for your kids. It's huge, and we've made some big shifts over the last couple of year and a couple months. Good question. We are coming up on 8 o'clock. Yes, ma'am. The question was about extended day and the supports that we're giving for the kids that maybe need a little extra time and to get the standards. Our goal, our hope, our mission is to provide the same supports under the new standards and even more where we can, for those kids. Just because we are having more rigorous standards doesn't mean we're going to be moving at a faster pace. Matter of fact, we have fewer standards. We can go more. We can go deeper with those standards. It has flexibility in it. The way that we're teaching, again, forget Common Core, forget Florida Standards, forget Next Gen. Just the way that we're delivering instruction in our classrooms is going to be different. You will see a huge shift in our classrooms, in your child's classroom. So if they're getting supports now through extended school day, or any other supports that we provide, then those supports will be there. Some of the things that we're talking about, we haven't nailed down all the details, but we're looking at summer math camps. We're looking at summer reading camps. Listen, what happens to our students during the summer months is tragic. It's tragic. A lot of those kids, particularly in the lower socioeconomic brackets, what happens is during the summer months, they start going down, and that's when they get back into school, and then it takes the teacher in that classroom at least a semester or more to even get them up where they would have been at the end of the last school year before they even start teaching them what they need to know. If I were king and I could do this at the shake of a magic wand, and my staff may be cringing, I think, maybe not, I would have year-round school. I would have year-round school, and I'm talking 45-15, but no tracks. If you know anything about Pasco's 45-15, I went to school under the old 45-15. Four different tracks, that was horrible. But where we're in 45 and we're out 15. We're in 45 and we're out 15. Because the way that the kids, they don't have as much time to forget. It also gives us the opportunity to do those camps and those extracurricular supports in those 15-day increments. The other thing I would do if I were king, I would have a longer school day. I think we're missing the mark. I really do. And what we need to do, and I think our principals in our elementary schools particularly know this, as well as our teachers, and I don't want to sound like an ogre, but we are rapidly, if not already, phasing out Fun Fridays. We need to do time on task. We have our kids for a very short period of time. We need to maximize that time. Moms and dads may get wrapped around the axle on that one. But what's more important? I want to make sure that your kids are getting it. I want to make sure they're getting the best education they possibly can from this district, from your school, from your classroom teacher. And so what we're doing is we're really need to look at time on task. Are we maximizing our time in those classrooms, elementary, middle, and high school? Okay? Yes, ma'am. You do have a full day's work, but I will tell you, what it boils down to. Money. It boils down to resources. It really does. It's an expensive proposition. Your district school budget is a little over $1 billion. Half of that is grant money. Half of that is state and federal money. The rest we generate locally. So it's down to resources, and we maximize those resources best we can. I will tell you, our teachers will turn a sow's ear into a silk purse. I've seen it. They can make a dollar go further than I have ever seen a teacher make a dollar go further. When you go in there and see the innovative things that are going on in classrooms and how those kids are engaged, it's a good thing. It's 8 o'clock. I've kept you long enough, but let me just say this before you get out of here. First off, I want to thank you again for taking your time tonight on a Tuesday night to come in and learn more about your children's education. I want to thank you for allowing us to educate your children. We know you have options. We know that. We know that. And we want to be able to compete. Our schools, this high school, the middle schools, and the elementary schools that feed this school, we want to compete as a district. We want to provide the very best education that your child could get anywhere. That is our mission. That is our commitment to you. We are thrilled to educate your children. It's not easy work, not just because it's your child, but it's hard work. But we're turning out great, great kids in this district because we got great teachers, great administrators, and great parents. Thank you, thank you, thank you, and hope you have a great night.